So, in completing module one of the class, I find it interesting that many of the reasons that I took the class are starting to already become answered. Interestingly enough, when I told my daughter that I was taking the class, my children are biracial. They are half Saudi Arabian, and we actually lived there for the first 10 years of my oldest daughter's life. And my younger daughter said, "Mom, don't you think it's funny that you're taking this class on racial and ethnic diversity and you have children that are racially diverse?" And we kind of laughed about it, but at the end of the day, my kids know that in being a lifelong learner, I had already kind of looked at the reasons I was taking the class. And as I told her, despite the fact that I've done a lot of research and a lot of reading on racial relations and raising biracial children, as well as my point of view and reflexivity in being a white woman raising brown children. I feel like this, one of the purposes it said in the first module is to further engender the self-critique process of cultural norms. And I feel that I already do that, but I think even when you do that currently or have had a history of doing it, it's important to keep taking classes like this because it's like a muscle that we work out at the gym. It's like a conversation that we have at the dinner table. The more often you do it, and the more probing you are when you do it, the more growth we can have from this experience. And we can't have change without growth. Even though change is the only norm, the only constant and all that. So then what I should be saying is we cannot have positive change and growth without this inquisition. And I think too that taking this class to me was being once again more informed about a discussion that it's important to hear from another viewpoint. And so would I even take this class again from another professor? Yes, because until we are informed on all levels, and I really enjoyed Dr. Anderson and how he speaks and his how he broke down the ideas of religious freedom and the benefits of a diverse democracy. So many of the things that maybe I had a awareness on the edge of my consciousness and just like making them, come forward in my consciousness. And also looking into the legalities of race relations. And interestingly enough, just with this first module, being able to look at even this whole idea of voter inequity and having more information about it as I see things on the news, and being able to discern from what I see on the news what I feel may be correct and what might not be correct. And so anyways, going into some of the guiding questions, because I think it's really important in doing that self-critique is starting from the self and starting from the why in the center and looking at how we self-identify. Oftentimes, if you have the open heart, will help you find those chinks in your armor, so to speak, about where you might need to have some growth, or you might need to do a little research, or you might need to put yourself in someone else's shoes to have more empathy. So, I identify in a very unique way, and this with everything else in all of these relations is. And this is coming from an art teacher. So, what is interesting to me is how often we take a visual or we take a piece of something and we identify it with a label. So, often people meet me, and this was interesting because when I was in Saudi for 10 years, I had a lot of experiences where the way I look definitely informed how people treated me. And so that was very eye-opening. But because I'm a naturally empathic person, it was really interesting when I started my master's. So I did my master's in art, but I did a program that is in it's at Goddard College in Vermont, and it is a Master of Fine Art in Interdisciplinary Art. But in your interdisciplinary art, you also have to explore transformative growth through a practicum in process. And my work as an artist at the time and to this day had to do with race and gender and mother-child relationships. So I did a lot of reading, as I said before, and did that. But interestingly enough, I grew up in a very small town in Wisconsin. So, those pieces of my identity that have changed so much as I grew and as I lived overseas have really served to inform my identity beyond what I was born into. The parts of my identity that, and this is a really telling question, I feel, this guiding question of what are the parts of your identity that matter more than others? And as I approached that, the pieces of my identity that matter more to me actually had less to do with my ethnicity and my heritage than how I identify as a person in the roles that I play in life. And that to me is interesting too, because when I look at people that I'm trying to understand how they're coming at this with such a strange point of view, when I look at the pieces of their identity that probably shape them, it's very telling. So I going back to myself, the pieces of my identity that matter more than others are my identity as a mother, a teacher, a lifelong learner, an artist, as a writer or creator, and a person who enjoys physical activity, particularly yoga, and found my heart in it with dealing with trauma as a healer. I think this is all very interesting because that goes back to the self-critique process and cultural norms that they asked us to look at too. And I took the class primarily to try and figure out what my role in this new society will be. And that is continually changing and shifting, but I feel that, and I saw a post the other day where it said, there's going to be some people that do certain things and there's certain roles. And what really spoke to me in that is the role of creating and healing. And this also goes into, for me, the additional resources that Dr. Anderson had us looking at, the most I don't want to say earth-shattering because I had an awareness of this, but the thing that spoke to me the most was the video with the dolls. And I tried to pull this apart and find out why this is the case, because when Mimi was little, for Christmas, like the first Christmas that she could verbalize what she wanted, she said she wanted a brown dolly. And so here's me searching the entire country of Saudi Arabia. Just, anybody who's lived there, that's kind of a joke because I couldn't drive there. So I buses, taxis, whatever, but going to all these places trying to find a brown dolly for her. And my mom back in the States actually found her a brown dolly and sent it. And to me, the Dell thing was very interesting. And it oddly enough, somebody who I don't even think is taking this class posted this video in my timeline feed or in their timeline feed on Facebook. And I read the comments on it, and it was so shocking to me the way people responded. So not only did I get to kind of process my response to it, but then to see how others responded was very interesting to me. Once again, having done my master's of fine arts in ethnicity and gender and how that related to how I raised my children, of course, that video was very interesting to me. So I really feel that module one has opened up for me a areas of inquiry that make this more interesting, revitalized my previous conceptions of how I raised my children and what they've gone through. And it's interesting because now Mimi is 26 and Sophie's going to be 26 and Sophie's going to be 21. And being able to see all of this kind of culminate as they are starting their young adulthood and the differences that their children will face and the way things will be easier for their children. So, pretty much as the self-reflection, I think this cultural identity I have in the broader historical context and my life experience is interesting because it's brought me back to the role of teacher and teacher as creator and healer. Okay, lots of information there. Thanks for listening if you're one of my peer editors, and I can't wait for the next three modules. Thank you.